We're about to begin our special community meeting. It's 3:10, so I'm sure we may have some folks walking in later, but we will begin at this time. And as your agenda states, my name is Princess Pope, and I am the Education Committee Chair of Monterey County Branch of the NAACP. And I think I know everyone in here. So thank you very much for coming. We are at Friendship Baptist Church, and we're expecting Reverend Dunham here with us today, but today's his birthday. So we send him birthday wishes, and we're going to have Brother Ray Pope in his absence to come and do the prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we'd like to thank you for that special occasion. It's a very special occasion for one of us to pass his birthday. We'd like to bless him. We'd also like to bless the NAACP and maybe here fight so hard for this community. We'd like to bless the superintendent. We'd like to bless this meeting so we can have full involvement. Thank you, everybody, for sharing.
Amen. Amen. Now, the Pledge of Allegiance. To the flag of the United States of America, in your mind,
in your love,
for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Already heard from Brother Ray Pope. Next we have Deborah Grunswacher, who's on our MPUSD Board of Trustees, and Alana Miles, who's also on our MPUSD Board of Trustees. We have Ed Armstrong, long-term member of the NAACP and membership chair. So I urge all of you to get some membership applications from him and solicit for other members. At the next table, we have Lisa Mitchell. Lisa is a new executive committee member with the NAACP, very active in the community. We have Ian Oglesby, as you all know, who is our political action chair. And we have a community member, very active, Marion, who's present with us today. We also have Stacy. Stacy is our youth works co-advisor, very active in the Village Project, and we thank this young lady for coming and bringing so much energy and expertise. We have Ms. Charles, Rosalind Charles, who's also a member of the NAACP and active in the community as well, and our wonderful president of the branch, Regina Mason. Okay, and without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you our very own MPUSD Superintendent, P.K. Diffenbaugh. He needs no further
ado. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, and thank you for making this opportunity possible. I know you had to move some things around, so I really appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak really get some feedback, hear questions, concerns around a potential for a facilities bond that we're considering moving forward to a ballot sometime, hopefully June in 2018. But what I wanted to do first is just kind of start with the state of MPUSD, give you some overview, some of the highlights of things going on, and then kind of transition into more of a facilities focus. So really beginning, just want to start with our vision, which is to become one of the finest public school systems in the country. We know that we're still a far way away from achieving that vision, but that's our vision, that's our standard, that's what we're shooting for. We don't want to just be the best here locally, the best in California. We want to be among the top performing public systems in the country. You may have noticed, I know not many people get the Herald anymore, but in the Herald over the summer, there was an article about the culture changes happening within MPUSD. And over the last 3 years, some of the changes that have happened, some of the progress that was made. And it was a nice just kind of marker about, you know, when we look at a sports team, a new coach comes in, they usually get In terms of just some of the building and cultural of excellence, some of the highlights we want to let you know about is, one is the investment in early childhood education. We know that early childhood education is one of the best investments you can make in terms of long-term gains for students. So when I first got here, we only had a half-day preschool program. Now we have both half-day as well as a full-day preschool option at the Seaside Children's Center and at Marina Del Mar preschool. We have only a few transitional kindergarten sites. Transitional kindergarten is an extra year of kindergarten for students who qualify. But you had to be born within a very narrow range, September 2nd to, I think it was December 1st. If you fall outside that range, it wasn't open to you. So what we did is we extended the age range now to September 2nd through March 1st. And anyone who turns 5 within that period can attend an extra year of high quality care. We don't, as a district, get compensated from the state until the student turns 5. So even if they start at 4, as long as they turn 5 some year in the school year, we only start getting paid from the state or compensated from the state there. But we felt like this was a very worthy investment. And as a result, over 250 more kids are attending transitional kindergarten. That's an extra year of high quality care. And we're certainly proud of that investment. Music and the arts has been something that we're very, very focused on. When I got here, there was 2 music teachers for the entire elementary school district, so 11 sites, which now we have 6 music teachers. So we have 1 music teacher for every 2 sites. That plus additional investment has allowed us to increase music from TK through 12th grade. So everyone has opportunity for music. Through investments that the board made, we now expanded instrumental music to 4th grade, starting in 4th grade and continuing on into 5th. And then in the middle school, it's an option. It's an elective that students can continue to make in the middle and high school. We partnered with the California, with the Monterey County Arts Council to have a partnership in the schools program for artists. These are artists that come in through the Arts Council. They get compensated and they teach art with our students. And that's been a great program. For example, we had Tandy Beal Dance Company, which is out of Santa Cruz County, come and they did a world of dance where they introduced to all 3rd graders across the entire district different cultural dances from different parts of the world. And it culminated in a performance with the students and the professional dancers for their families. It was very, very widely loved by all. And then one thing just to highlight that we're very proud of is that Martin Luther King Elementary School received a Turnaround Arts grant from the California Turnaround Arts Program, which is an offshoot of Michelle Obama's initiative to transform schools not through more math or more English, but through the arts. And so what they do is it's not a lot of money, but they give you training in how to incorporate arts into everyday lessons. They give you some supplies, and then they pair you with an artist that brings publicity and potentially fundraising. And so Jackson Brown was our artist chosen for MLK, and he did a benefit concert that raised over $40,000 for MLK School of the Arts this fall, so that was very exciting. And if you have not been to the School of the Arts, to MLK recently, I encourage you to go. There's a lot happening there that's really exciting for our students. Some may have heard a little bit more about this because it's been in the paper a little bit, but the Reimagining Secondary Learning Initiative. So this is where we really try to transform our secondary schools, moving to the International Baccalaureate in Monterey learning community, to New Tech Network, which is a project-based learning one-on-one computing in Seaside, for Seaside Middle and Seaside High, with a computer science focus. So in Seaside High, every freshman is in an integrated computer science math class, so they're exposed to computer science. And then there's a pathway to which you can be an AP computer science by the time you graduate high school. And many of our students have gone on to the CS3 program, partnership through Hartnell and CSUMD. So if you're coming out of college with a computer science degree, the world is available for you. There's a lot of jobs that are highly sought after to try to, they bring people in from other countries because we don't have enough trained people here. So we're very excited about that. In Marina, we have an early college and career model. So we partnered with MPC. So this year, every freshman at Marina is exposed to two college courses, and one in the fall and one in the spring. We're developing a pathway where if a student is ambitious enough, they can earn an AA degree and a high school diploma at the same time, so over their 4 years. So that's 2 years of college education out of the way in high school. Now that isn't for everyone. That's a very rigorous load. You're going to have to take some courses in the evening summers, but it's a pathway that we're developing with our partnership with MPC. There was a new law that allowed now you can offer MPC classes or community college classes on your campus just for your students. And so we have that at all of our high schools, Marina, Seaside, and Monterey, but in Marina, it's a real pathway we're developing to get an AA degree. Central Coast High School, which you may have read, just received a distinction as a model continuation school for the state of California, one of 30 chosen. We're very proud of the work that they're doing there. It's a project-based learning. They have a really budding culinary program as well as a medical program. It's allowing kids to move at their own pace. Many kids get credits up and they go back to their home school. Some kids like it so much there, they choose to stay and graduate from Central Coast High School. In terms of military commitment, we have about 10% of our kids are military connected, meaning their parents are in the military, they work for the military, live on military land, and we're committed to them and have gone after two competitive grants. So these aren't given to most districts. And we were lucky enough to receive both. They're over $1 million grants over 5 years, targeted towards our military impacted schools. The first grant was to support social emotional support and transition for many of our kids who in 5 years' time may go to 8, 10 more schools, right? So this is really to help their transition and the support providers, behavioral, mental health counselors, as well as community liaisons for them. And then we just received a grant for STEM education, and this is for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics to support that in our military impacted schools. So we're very excited about that. Social emotional support has been a focus of ours. We know that many of our kids are overcoming a number of challenges in order to be successful, and we need to support them to do that. So in addition to the positive behavior intervention support, which is a framework that is in many California and across the country, we've invested in a full-time social emotional counselor at each of our secondary schools, as well as one social emotional counselor for every two elementary schools. And many elementary schools have then used their Title I funding bring that position to be full time. We have an academic on track dashboard that is really helping keep track of kids who are chronically absent, who are below, not doing well in their classes, in order to really help put in pre-interventions in place. We have a number of community partnerships. The picture you see, that's a community partnership for youth, which is in many of our schools, including this picture is at Walter Colton Middle School. And they, through a partnership with us, they start actually at 12 rather than after school, and they're there for the second half of the day and then into the afternoon. And they're near peer mentors to a number of our kids there. And I'll talk about it a little bit more, but what we've seen in the last 4 years is a dramatic reduction in suspensions, and that's a result of the positive behavior intervention supports we put in place. I do want to talk a little bit about our commitment to equity. I know that this is one of our pillars. I wanted just to highlight some of the hires that we've made since I've come on board in 2004. I've hired the associate superintendent, unfortunately. Dr. Mary Perry-Reed is now a superintendent herself in Minnesota. But very, very happy for her and her family. Other hires are Dr. Will Nelson, is the director, secretary of education. We have a director of facilities, Dietrich Brown, who came up through our schools and through our community in MPUSD. Misha James is our director of tuition services. Tia Robinson, director of early childhood education. Many of you know Giselle Stingwell, which is our safety and prevention coordinator. We have Principal Marshall, assistant principal at Marina High, assistant principal at Monterey High, and our facilities maintenance supervisor are all leadership positions that we've hired since my time started. And that's a commitment that we have to try to diversify our leadership to reflect the community in which we serve. Other things that I wanted to highlight, because I know it's of interest for the NAACP Education Committee, is how we're doing with our students. And I'll be the first to tell you we have a long way to go. But I did want to highlight some of the progress that we've made. So in 13-14, 19% of our African American males graduated, meeting the A through G requirements. A through G are the minimum requirements you need to apply to the CSU UC system. So that's a list of courses with which you need to pass with a C or better. By 15-16, that number rose to 50% of our African American male graduates. In 13-14, since 13-14, our advanced placement courses have grown across the board, with the most dramatic increase being African American students, moving from only 22% to 49% in terms of students enrolled in an AP course. In 13-14, 17% of African American males were suspended in the district. Now that percentage has been reduced to 9.8%. And we expect this year, based on our current data, to continue to see a reduction in suspensions. I do want to note that is still disproportionate data, meaning that African Americans make up around 5% of our student population. So you ideally want to see below the number of that suspended. But the trend has been a dramatic reduction, and we are very hopeful that we will continue that trend and get below the disproportionate line. Something I'm really proud of is recently Seaside High School was named the School of Opportunity by the National Education Policy Center. It's one of eight schools nationally recognized as a school that closes the opportunity gaps for kids. And it was featured in the Washington Post. And there'll be a further story highlighting each of the eight schools, including Seaside High, in the Washington Post. And we're really, really proud of that, particularly because Seaside High was, at one point, a school improvement grant school. And that was it was recognized as one of the lower performing schools in California and given extra money through the school improvement grant program, which was through the Obama administration. Well, they've done a number of studies on the six schools. They call them six schools. And most six schools improved when money was coming in over the three-year period. Then when the money stopped, they reverted back, and they did not improve after. So there's a big headline in one of the papers that said, you know, this was the biggest waste of money that you could have done. But not the case for Seaside High. They have continued their turnaround and now are recognized as a school of opportunity. And we're very excited about that. And then I did mention Central Coast High School is one of 30 model continuation schools. So we're very excited by that. And that was a press release by the state public education superintendent. So I mentioned more work to do in our commitment to equity. We know that many of our students are not being successful in our system, are not graduating ready for college and career. And we have more work to do. One of the exciting things we've done is we've partnered with Pacific Education Group, and that's a group started by Glenn Singleton, who wrote a book called The Racist Conversations on Race. And we've partnered with them for what they call organizing for systemic racial equity. And that starts with the cabinet and the senior leadership and site leaders going through a number of trainings, first with called Beyond Diversity, and then leadership training with Lead for Educational Equity. And then it expands out from there to where last week we had over 80 educators in a two-day seminar called Beyond Diversity, which is having learning about the culture, the Courageous Conversation on Race protocol, examining the role of whiteness and the culture of whiteness and how it impacts our students and how our students feel in our schools. And we'll continue to talk about culturally relevant pedagogy and curriculum. And each school is developing a care team, and that's a team of principal and teacher leaders who care deeply about equity on their campus and will work to increase these practices of, across their campuses with a constant action research on how are our kids doing, how do we know that they're responding to this, and how are we closing the gaps that have been persistent. We also have partnered with California Teachers Association, and our Teachers Association took the lead on this, MBTA, in an unconscious bias training. And that's training with educators in mind on the unconscious bias that we carry with us and how that those biases play out in our teaching and in our classrooms. In terms of diversifying the teaching staff, that's been a focus and will continue to be a focus. We launched a tuition reimbursement program, which is essentially we'll pay for $10,000 for you to get your credential a year if you agree to stay with us for a minimum of 5 years. So we'll pay for you to get your credential if you stay with us for at least 5 years. And we've had a number of people take advantage of that, and we want to continue to do that because that can allow us to recruit and develop our educators locally, which is all the more powerful if the teacher themselves have come through our system. And then there's a residency model that we're looking into and developing. And the residency model is a little different than the traditional student-teacher education model, where a resident, you're actually, you spend a whole year learning under the an expert teacher. So you're in the classroom every day but Friday. Fridays you are in seminar. And at the end of that year, you have a job waiting for you. So it's not you go through the program and then you apply to a bunch of places. You're picked and you go through the training, and then at the end of that year, you are an MPUSD educator. And so we're looking to put those in place. That's a great model. It's modeled a little bit after the medical model, which is trying to say, in order to prepare you to be successful, we can't just throw you in to be a teacher. We need you to develop over time under the guise of an expert. And that's the residency model we're doing. Parent education programs, we've launched these, but we're trying to create more of a systemic approach. Where we have Javier Cuspuertas opening doors at many of our elementary sites. Positive parenting, which is a program which comes and trains your parents to then in turn be teachers to other parents. It's like a train the trainer model that we piloted this year and had great success at Foothill Elementary. And then PIQA, Parent Institute of Quality Education. They've done a number of seminars, and this is how you advocate best for your student within the system to make sure that he or she gets what they need. We We've also partnered with Strengthening Families through Community Services and offered that to many of our students as well. So we've gone over a number of these, but this is just, again, some of the things that we feel good about in terms of the progress that we've made, highlighting that, yes, we have work to do, but we've made significant progress. Also, we've been in the news quite a bit. We're trying to change the perception of MPUSD within the community. And now, we just had a recruitment fair on Saturday, and we had over 100 people come and sign up and come and interview. And the word was, we know this is a great district. We know this is a place to be where you can learn and grow as a professional. You want to be a part of it. That's very different if you come to the fair 2-3 years ago to where we are now, where we had our own teachers coming to the fair, talking up our schools to potential applicants. It's very exciting, the kind of change that's happening in terms of perception. So that's kind of an update on the some of the highlights of what we've done. I'm going to transition a little bit into school facilities specifically, and then open it up for questions and comments. So just as a quick reminder, Measure P was passed in 2010. That was a facilities bond, and it was for $110 million. And it was passed with 71% of the vote, so a very high percentage. You need 55% to pass a facilities bond, so it was pretty, if you can pass the 70% threshold, it's considered a pretty strong victory. And we've done a number of things that have worked on our facilities, which many are aging. So I'll just highlight some of the things we've done in terms of HVAC systems, some of which were original boilers that were put in when the schools were built. Electrical systems, again, that could no longer hold the amount of electricity needed to run a school. Technology, replacing digitizing our clocks, our bell systems, our phone systems. We purchased a number of furniture for our systems that were for our schools, which were very, very old. Painting, did a number of painting, which is actually a huge process because so much of the paint was lead paint, so you have to do a full abatement of your facilities in order, can get quite costly in order to paint it. ADA access, including our access to our, which is a requirement when you do a number of improvements across sites, and we replaced out-of-compliance playground systems. Additionally, we redid a number of bathrooms across the district to have a little bit better place for students and staff, and increased both safety and energy. On that. So a lot of the initial Measure P funds were invested in infrastructure, which isn't necessarily something that people do backflips over, right? You know, because it's not super exciting, but it's necessary. You can't have kids in cold classrooms. You can't have electric outlets that one in the front and one in the back, which we still do in many of our campuses. But for the second half of Measure P, we did focus on some bigger projects that we were excited about. So go through them first. So one at Seaside High School, we're replacing 12 out-of-date portables. And when I say out-of-date portables, I mean portables that have been there 30-plus years with 21st century classrooms. So these are really state-of-the-art classrooms. And we're very excited about this. This will help support the project-based learning model that's going on at Seaside High School. We're also renovating the library to make it a multimedia center. So it'll be a library, but it'll also have a number of other things that our kids are really interested in doing, whether it's kind of a makerspace type model. And what was great is we really engaged the kids in what do they want to see in their library. How do they want to design it? So it's going to be a very exciting project. At Marina High School, we're putting a gym at Marina. As many of you know, Marina doesn't have a gym, so they play every game on the road. They struggle to find practice facilities, and so it was very important to the community, and it will be a joint use, it'll be a school district facility, but through our partnership with the city, it can be used for city functions as well. At Monterey High School, we're creating a Science and Innovation Center, and this will be kind of right at the entrance of campus, and I think is really going to transform the whole entryway. This is going to be a two-story structure with larger state-of-the-art science labs on the top. On the bottom, there'll be kind of a mini lecture facility as well as a more open space that not just science, but any classroom can come and use. So it'll be open. So that's exciting. And then Central Coast, we're creating a culinary kitchen. This is a teaching kitchen. So right now they have a great culinary program that's kind of jammed into a very small kitchen that was not designed for teaching. So this is going to be a great teaching facility where they'll, you know, someone will be teaching you how to chop, and there'll be a, you know, a TV screen that you can see that really helps the culinary program. That's something that they're very excited about. So we're doing a few bigger projects with the remainder of the NAACP that we think are going to be really transformational to a number of our campuses, and really impact the learning that happens on campus, and that's really exciting. So in terms of the $110 million of Measure P, that money has either been spent or allocated. Right? So it's either been spent on a lot of the infrastructure projects that we've done, or it's been allocated to these bigger projects that you have to go through the state architectural board that is quite a process in there. So we've done that, we're in the process, but we have not broken ground on these projects yet. With that said, the newest facility we have that our students are in, or 1965, it was built in 1965. So that's the newest facility our students currently occupy. And so there's a tremendous amount of need across the district in addition to the Measure P investments. So if you look at whether it's replacing roofs, structural repair at Seaside High School, modernization of a number of restrooms, removal of old carpet and tile, that some of which has asbestos beneath it because that's how they used to do it. So a number of hazmat that needs to be replaced. Just basic infrastructure, electrical, gas, sewer lines, security fencing needs to be updated. And then we need to look at our classrooms, our libraries, our science labs, our career technical spaces. They were all built for the 20th century. They were all built the 50s, 60s, some in the 20s, but it was built for a very different time period. If we want to move our kids into being prepared for the 21st century, we need to have our facilities reflect that, and that needs to be updated. So a great example of that is many of our classrooms have one plug in the front and one plug in the back. Because at that 19th century, I guess that was enough to do it. Now when you have every kid with a computer in the classroom with a number of interactive whiteboards, you need a different amount of electricity to boost that. Athletic facilities, I know a number of you have noticed probably better than I do, but our facilities are really in desperate need of repair. You'll see here the lower left, that's the picture of what used to be a lower field at Monterey High School that's now a dirt parking lot. And so Monterey High has really one usable field. So football practices on one half of the field and field hockey practices on the other. So sometimes the balls will go through, it's not the ideal environment. So we need another practice facility there. Our pool at Monterey High was built in the 20s. Seaside High is in desperate need. Our locker rooms, the one in the upper left is my personal favorite because Apparently, at one point, hundreds of kids took a shower at the same time. Now, no one will take a shower in the locker room. It's just not part of, I guess, what kids do. You have to have a few, because legally you have to have a few. But these were kind of the military-style showers that just is not needed or what's wanted. And then, probably the biggest thing from my perspective is that we have about 100 portables existing district-wide. And most of those portables have outlived their shelf life. You know, so your portables are meant to be temporary facilities, and our district have been replaced and then left. There's some, and the ones in Monterey High, which actually aren't even the first in the district, I was told were placed there in 1970. So they're 48 years old. And they built them pretty good, because that's better than some of the other ones we have. Here, I think you're seeing some at the ones at Seaside High, which fortunately we're gonna replace with the latest. But virtually at every campus, if you go to Olson Elementary, half the school is portables, because it was built at a time when they were building small schools for the neighborhood. And then as they grew, they just kept adding portables along. So that's certainly an area of focus, is to replace portables with permanent. What is the district considering doing? We're considering putting a $213 million bond on the June ballot. And I know $213 million is a lot of money. When we did a facility assessment of how would we bring all of our facilities up to 21st century standards, we replace all the portables, do everything we want with the athletic facilities, do all the infrastructure, the price tag came back at about $680 million to do it all. So 213 is a lot, but it's still, doesn't get us even a third of the way there in terms of the need that we have across the district. And that's primarily because the newest facility was built in the 60s. So if we're looking at this, we conducted a poll over the summer, asked likely voters what they were thinking. The amount would be $60 per 100,000 of assessed value. And I emphasize assessed because that's different than market value, right? Your assessed value has to do with when you purchased your house plus any marginal increase over the years due to Prop 13, which caps the amount that they can increase. Whereas your home value is what you could sell it on the market, right? So there's a difference there. And 78% indicated initially, yes, I'll support this. So that was a strong number, and I was very happy that we were above 55% in every demographic, meaning Democrats, Republicans, senior citizens, newer voters, all came back over 55%.
So is that just,
across the district? It's across all the communities in the district that we did the poll. And, you know, they do the poll based on likely voters, so that's
people. I didn't get a poll.
Yeah. I mean, they have the statistical method that, you know, that's why they have a plus or minus, right? It could be off by a little bit either way, because it's not an exact science. But we would need to get across 55%. So we feel like we're starting in a strong at least initial support. But the way they do polls too is then they read a whole bunch of negative things and then say, now what do you think? And after they read a bunch of negative things, we dropped from 78 to 68, right? So we're not we're susceptible, right? You know, if there's a negative campaign, we dropped by 10 percentage points. Still above 55, which was encouraging, but just does show that, you know, this is not that messages do count, and certainly if we move forward, there will be a separate campaign committee that's set up and works, and that's separate from the district. So that's what we're considering. We believe it's an investment in our facilities, as an investment in our kids. We believe our kids deserve to go to schools that are prepare them for the 21st century, and facilities is part of that. And so that's the question. The board is considering considering putting it on the June ballot. If we didn't go in June, the possibility would go in November 2008. If you don't go in 2008, because of a new law that's passed, you'd have to wait till 2020. So it's a, you can't go in odd years anymore. You have to go in an even year where the congressional election is up and then everyone in the district is voting, rather than targeting a year that some the strategy was at one point target years where not many people go to vote, and then you can get your people to show up and you'll pass it, and they pass a law, so you have to do it in an even years. So if it's not 2018, the next possible one we could do is 2020. So with that, I'll take a breath and open it up to any questions or comments or feedback.
So in terms of these contractors that got hired for Measure P, were any of them local, number one, and then was there any effort on the part of the district to come into communities, to engage communities, to see if there were residents that could be involved in some sort of apprenticeship so that they could learn the trade and have jobs?
To answer the first question, yes, there's a number of local folks that did the work for the subcontractors were local, so one or two. And we advertise, and you, like you have to, in the local papers and the local union shops and union job boards and all that. So that, we definitely prefer to have local people do it and advertise locally to have folks, and many of the workers certainly were local workers. In terms of the apprenticeship model, that's not something that that we've done, and it would be, I'm not sure how you would do that in the context of the bond. I guess you could try to hire someone that has an apprentice program already, but
I'm not talking about the bond, but I'm talking about that you're going to put the bond out for what you want. But are you going to encourage the school board to give favorable support to a contractor that is willing to, especially because Prop 47 has formally incarcerated people,
sure,
and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
And if I were a taxpayer, which I am,
yeah,
and my property taxes would be assessed, then I would want to know that our local people, especially historically underserved people and specifically African Americans,
yeah,
who are the ones that are heavily incarcerated, that are coming back to the community, could have something to look forward to in terms of learning a trade and that kind of thing. So is that something that has even been thought about?
So I have to look into this. I know that when you put out a bid for a project, by law you have to go for the lowest bidder.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have to look into, are there other stipulations you can put in to say, mm-hmm, the lowest bidder that has X, Y, or Z? That I just have to look and see if that's a possibility. I don't know. But I know the law is pretty clear around low bids. I think that certainly outside of the context of the bond, working on construction trades or through our adult school or others is something we could definitely try to do. But once the bond money is involved, there's some pretty specific guidelines of what you have to follow, and that I just have to do a little more research on. I'm not 100% sure what type of conditions you can put in on those matters, because I know there's a lot of that. What people are concerned about is districts trying to funnel a contract to a specific,
yeah,
person, where you're supposed to keep it, it's supposed to be anyone, and then you're supposed to go to the lowest bidder. So that's what I just have to look into. I don't know the specifics around it.
And I know that the city of Seaside would, back in the day when we had progressive people on the city council, they would have contractors, minority-owned contractors, and even the government does, so I don't see why, you know, maybe something like that. I don't know what it is or if it's, you know, but that's definitely something that I would like to see some due diligence put into, in terms of, you know, because we have a lot of people coming out of incarceration that need jobs, and what better way to learn than on-the-job training with a skilled contractor? So, anyway.
Yeah, something I can definitely do a little more research on. Yes?
I have a question also on the bond issue. January 31st, about 10 or 11 o'clock, I was at Seaside High School setting up a Black History display, and I actually took pictures on my phone. There were about 50 men, white men, walking around the campus, clearly assessing the buildings. One had hard hat and one had blueprints. Now, my question is, how closely are the funds monitored? I think 50 people, and I'm not over-exaggerating, that's why I took the picture. I mean, it's too many people to be on the campus assessing whatever they're doing, and each one of those people have to get paid. So are we using that bond money in the smartest way?
Yeah, I'd have to see. Sometimes you do a pre-bid walk. So what you do is you say, who wants to bid on this? You advertise it, and then they come to the site, and then you show them around and say, this is the site, this is what needs to happen, these are the plans, da 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 da. So just guessing, like if it was 50 people,
yeah.
My guess is it was a number of, you know, contractors and their firms coming to the pre-bid site walk. That's not something we pay them for, they come on their own. So I'd have to know a little bit more about the specifics, but if it's 50 people, I can imagine something like that, because that would be something we wouldn't have that many people, you know, on our dime. But in terms of oversight, we do have a citizens oversight board, citizens bond advisory board that is monitoring to see if the funds are expended in the way that the voters approve. So that's something that you have to have as a citizens oversight committee board. In addition to that, you also do two audits. You do a performance, a financial audit of your bond and a performance audit of your bond. And that's something we do every year also by law. And so far we've got clean audits. These are external auditors coming in and managing and looking at those different things. So, your specific thing, I'd have to learn a little bit more about it. But yes, I'm confident that we're spending the money as intended, trying to save as much as we can for the projects.
So did the audit measure P prove that you stayed true to the course?
Yes.
Yep,
we had clean audits.
Well, that's what I wanted to understand, because I don't really know how a population P, or how do we educate the community in someone that we don't know about population P, but we come in with another bond. But what you are saying is very good. I mean, we know we have to update, and people have to be aware of that to be competitive, but how do we get the community to know that this is really needed and really going to work? But it's definitely needed.
Yeah. So I think we got a lot of outreach to do, and should we get on the ballot, you have to have a separate campaign committee. So
yeah.
The district can't on district time campaign, right? Or you
right.
can't use district funds to campaign. So a separate committee has to be formed, and then they have to, you know, do the campaign work, knocking on doors, phone calls.
Yeah.
They have to raise money to do, send out flyers and things like that. So that's all to come. If we move forward to put it on, we've tried to do. You know, when I first got here, there wasn't any signage about the stuff we've done.
Right.
So now at each of our campuses, you'll see, you know, your measure team bond dollars at work with pictures of the different projects, and so that's been good. And we're developing a two-pager that says, you know, here's some of the projects that we're doing, and then on the flip side, it has every school and what projects have been done at every school. And then we'll post that on the web and try to get that out to people. So we'll hopefully, you know, do that. I think you're absolutely right. The people who have come onto our campuses know the state of our facilities. But if you haven't come onto our campuses, you may not know. And that will be our effort to engage and do outreach.
Okay.
Outside of the bond issue, you brought up a number of accomplishments of the district, and they all sound absolutely fabulous, fine, and dandy. But I'm here to just look at this from a different perspective based on what I see. And I see Black children that are in a program, in an after-school program, being left behind. Oftentimes, our education committee has to sit in on IEP meetings. If they don't have a person that is available, they come to the NAACP. And we have a lot of cases backed up because we're all volunteers. And as good as all these wonderful things are for kids that are doing well, but we have a boatload of children right out of this community that are doing extremely poorly. And I came to a school board meeting where you had on the screen about the LCAP funding and some grants you're getting. And one of the things you mentioned is that you're going to be partnering with the Village Project. Well, I know that, you know, I had met with you personally with Mel regarding some funding for those kids in the after-school program. Our agency is a therapeutic clinic. We're providing these after-school programs because kids need it. Okay, not because we have extra time or any of that. And we're meeting a great need, and it's not being funded by MPUSD. So I feel like there's a term called poverty pimping. Excuse my expression of it, but it may resonate with me. In that, I feel like I personally am being used as a community member to write for grants to pay for those kids in that after-school program. Now, if I didn't write those grants, those kids would not be allowed to have that kind of resource. Now, I went over to Marshall or Olson, and I saw that the kids were being picked up on the city bus. And they were taken to their after-school program. Now, I asked the person, hey, what's this about? They said, oh, the school district's paying for these kids to get picked up and taken to their after-school program in Marina. And I said, well, I'll be darned. Why isn't that happening for the Black children in Seaside? So I feel like there needs to be some extreme dialogue with the office, because the NAACP is a civil rights organization. And when we see an equitable distribution of our resources not going to the kids that need it the most, then we have to say something about it. So we're going to be working with you and the education committee to deal with this issue. But before, we didn't have that problem because the other superintendent that was here just said, hey, you know what, this is great that this is happening. And way before the social emotional model that you all are using, this model has been being used from day one when Mae Johnson helped put this program together for the after school program that we run. And when I say we run, I'm a volunteer, okay? I could be using my time helping my community in different ways, but I'm giving back of my time because the school district, I believe, should help those children. We have several kids that are not reading at grade level. When I drive up in the van, I'll be the janitor, I'll do whatever is required so that these kids have what they want. And most people in our community will do that. They will step up to the plate, even though it's taxing on our time when we could be doing some other stuff that's needed, because other people have issues that they have to deal with that takes us away from. But the principal at Highland berated these two children, and the teacher berated these children in front of everyone, and I had to cut off the conversation. So when you say that these teachers are learning about you know, how implicit bias works and so on and so forth, and overcoming racial challenges, I am here to tell you that I can only go by the facts, and those are the facts that I see. And I know that we have a parent here also of kids in the after-school program. But what I'm trying to find out is why isn't fair and equitable distribution of our resources going to children of African ancestry. It's kind of like, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I just want to make you aware that you're not funding those kids, and those kids are from schools in the district. And I think that it's unfair to them and their families, because not only are those kids getting transportation, which a grant has to be written for, to get them a bus driver to drive them to and from, which takes away money from, you know, a tutor that could be working on one-on-one with them, but their parents get access to low-income support. There's a number of things that the parents aren't getting in this program that I'm just a little flabbergasted about, because I feel like information is being hidden from them. And when these bonds come out and when these contracts come out, the information is not coming to the community in a culturally congruent way. So basically, I'm here to request that, number one, the LCAP reconvening now, which we were, the black community was usurped. They did not come to us. We cannot be a cookie cutter approach. I realize that people only have so much time, but these people are getting paid to come into the community, to do outreach and engagement, to make sure all of the citizenry of this district are being engaged. But I really want to say that there is something to be said, and there's a body of evidence that suggests that culturally congruent services are imperative. And when your LCAP folks, we want the black community engaged based on our cultural dynamics, because it is going to take 225 years for African people of African ancestry to catch up with their white counterparts as a result of slavery. And I will send you the body of research that was done in 2016 about that. And so we're requesting the NAACP education, that was going to be one of our number one things to request, that the LCAP folks come to the black community and especially arrange so that we can get as many parents to the table so that our voices can be heard. Because quite frankly, while I don't mind helping and giving back to the community in the way I do, I feel like it is a ripoff of my time, because there is funding and it's going to other places. And we can't look at children as a number. Behind every child, there is an individual need that is not getting met. Not just, oh, we've got 300 kids in this program. No, that is why we have such poor outcomes. And so I'm not going to say anything else about so that other people can weigh in on this, but that's, you know, something that as a social worker, as a subject matter expert and a social worker by profession, I have to bring that to the table. And from a civil rights perspective, it is an issue, not with just the local NAACP, but the national and the state as well. So I want you to be aware of that.
I have a question. In the bond, when you said the athletic field, is Seaside High included in that?
Yeah, so right now, every facility is included as a potential bond project. So yes, what we did for the Measure P, second half of Measure P, and we would do for this bond is have a facilities advisory committee that helps prioritize. So if you have $680 million with a need, if $210 million, you're gonna have to prioritize. But in terms of Seaside High's facility and field, yes, it's on the radar for sure. And we're actually investing this spring and summer for new grass on the field, because of the current condition is not safe. And so while long-term, we definitely want a turf field and track, like Astro, now they call it a synthetic turf. In the meantime, we are making investments for that field.
So thank you for that. But let me ask you another question that may not be in here. What does the athletic program, what does that fall under? Like the funding for the athletic program as a whole, what does that fall into?
Yeah, so athletic funding comes through the general fund. So it's there's not a special categorical fund for athletics, so it has to come from the general fund.
So who measures it? the, who measured it, who measures it to see what's needed and what's not needed and what's acceptable and not acceptable? So the reason why I'm asking that, I'm glad you asked me, thanks for asking me. Seaside High, they want, I like what you said about how far they came. That's great, because I'm Seaside High. Seaside High, they just won as a, you know, the division champs. They just won as a division champ, so they came from sixth place to...
For basketball?
Right, yeah. So they came from sixth place to first place, so yeah, that's great. And that just enhanced what you said about the education part. But being a, I'm a grandparent, not a parent, so I went to quite a few away games. And those uniforms was the most disgusting thing, the most embarrassing thing that I have ever seen, that the boys had the uniforms like pinned up, like with a scrunchie. I said, what the heck? I said, well, maybe he just, they just put him in and he borrowed them. But then I even looked at my grandson's uniform. So I went directly to the coach. I said, what is up with the uniforms? We got to do better. We have to do better. And he said that, you have to check with the athletic department, because this is a continuous, basically it's a continuous fight. And I know that we as parents can have booster clubs and, you know, that type, you know, that type of stuff, because I'm sure some of us parents are getting together to make sure that the appreciation for them, that they got that far,
yeah,
what, you know, that they are appreciated. But how do you determine when's the time to buy the school new uniforms? Because not only is Seaside High, but Seaside High kind of represents Seaside.
Mm-hmm.
And those uniforms were just,
yeah,
I mean, they, especially when we went to Gilroy, mm-hmm, the way those kids stood out and the way Seaside High looked, I just felt like that was an indictment on the community as a whole. So I just wanted to know for myself, where does that money come and how is it determined?
Well, I can look into that specifically. I mean, usually they have, the sites have a uniform cycle, you know, where they're buying, you know, new for football, and then they don't buy for football for a number of years, and then, you know, that type of thing. So I have to figure out why, where Seaside High is and basketball is, and, you know, why they are looking like that. I don't know. I'd have to figure it out. But usually, you know, because you can't buy new uniforms every year for every sport.
Right.
So usually there's a, it's kind of a cycle.
Well, you can if the parents put together something and raise their own money, right?
Oh, yeah. Yes, right. Absolutely. Yeah, what I mean is...
Right, I understand what you said from the budget standpoint.
Correct. But certainly we don't want, you know, our kids or our community not feeling, you know, that they're representing with pride. So I feel like that.
Thanks.
So we still have most of the kids coming from Seaside in the district, right? You're proposing the, to put this proposal in for bond money, and
yeah,
I was interested in you kind of elaborating a little bit on what Regina Mason was talking about. Because a lot of our kids in Seaside is what fills the schools in Monterey and in Seaside. So a lot of our kids in Seaside are majority are the African American who get neglected in the district. And I was saying that because I'm dealing with Ortega said in Highland School right now myself with some issues that are going on, and they have the highest level of children. And you could probably correct me with that, because now all four schools, I think it's Seaside, King, Ortega and Delray Woods are now getting the free lunch program because of such a high number of kids that are low income, right? So, but Highland and Ortega's have the highest level of kids, right? So they're targeted by the principals, by those two principals, and I've been dealing with issues with parents and the community. Those two principals target poor kids because they're poor. And so you're asking for money to improve schools, and these kids will continue to suffer. So I was really interested in you addressing some of what
the
system is saying.
Yeah, so I mean, the specific cases you're talking about, we could talk afterwards and see, or I can even set up some time to do that. I think, you know, When I got there as the seventh superintendent in 10 years in the district, and the 14th superintendent in 30. So, you know, you have seven coaches in 10 years, you have seven CEOs in 10 years, you're going to have an organization that needs a lot of work. You know, that's the reality. You know, I feel like we have made progress. I know there's certain situations where we probably have not. But as a whole, when I am in the community and talking to different folks, including African-American parents, people recognize what it was and what it is and the progress that we've made. So that's not to say we can't do better or we need to do better. Absolutely, we absolutely have to do better. But I do feel like we have made some progress. You know, in terms of ways that we can work together, we can continue, you know, I would love to continue to sit down and try to figure out ways that we can work together. Certainly, you know, when I talk to Ben about the funding and different things, when you get a grant, there's some stipulations on the grant that you have to follow, right? So if the grant says you can't fund kids who don't go to this school, meaning aren't at this school after school, we can't take grant funds and jeopardize, you know, $1 million worth of grant funds and not do what the grant says we have to do. So there's some things that are harder than, it's not just a matter of, you know, and we've been trying to work ways around it, and so far we haven't been able to.
I'm not talking about your discussion with Ben, I'm talking about your discussion with Mel and I, when you could do that. So this is not a public conversation, I just wanted to bring it up because none of the kids are being funded by the school district for the children that are in the schools at Fort Terrace and Highland and Delray Woods, and you know.
Because when we looked into the funding, they said that you cannot fund an off-site program. Even if the kids are coming from that site and going off-site, the state said you could not take that money
to
off-site. So there's some things that, you know, I think I'll, you know, continue to try to work through. Yes?
So if I'm following correctly, how then will this bond affect the Village Project after school program in regards to updates? Because we're in three of the portals that I've ever seen here, and I was born on Form 4. And we now are fenced out by this green mesh that the district's putting up at sites. That's from what I've been told, per custodian, that it's for safety and security. But to me, it's an insult and it's disrespectful because we service school district, MPUSD children. And if it was for the safety and security, I would think it would be on the outer fences between the school and the street from the houses, not like boxing us out. So we have siblings and little cousins that used to be able to see each other through the fences and even touch fingers. And, you know, they were just kind of like somewhat traumatized by the mesh and the division. It also hinders us from seeing our children that are on the play yard from our portables. You know, they're out there supervised, of course, but we still need to have that ability to communicate visually. So it's an impairment to us. And so based on what you just said, kind of piggybacking the previous conversation about grants and how it can be used and us being outside district agency. So how does this bond work for us?
Yeah, so the answer is that the bond can be used for any district facility. So if you're on a district facility, then it can be used for that facility. At this point, we haven't made a project list, so I can't answer the specifics of whether the, you know, the, those specific portables are part of, going to be part of the project list. That is going to come, you know, with, you know, later discussions around prioritization, starting with some principles around health and safety, impact on student learning. You know, the board has put out some kind of basic principles. But, you know, I think it's when you have $680 million of need, you have $213 million to work with, you're not going to be able to do everything that needs to be done. And that's the real challenge, is that at every site, there are not wants, there are needs. You know, there are sewer systems that were made with terracotta pipe that are not, you know, I mean, those were put in long time ago. So there's a lot of decisions that need to be made in terms of how do we prioritize those funds. That would be
because when we break up the funds, it is that the schools on this side, they are serviced later instead of earlier. But what's the likeliness of, why isn't, maybe it's me, and I've been here, I haven't lived here, but I'm a part of the second generation family to the Peninsula. Why doesn't Seaside have its own unified school district when all the schools are here? They have the most schools. Why is it lumped into MPUSD? You know, like how Carmel is separate, PG is separate, Salinas has two or three. Why isn't Seaside like a standalone?
That's exactly what
I'll give you what I know about this, but I'm not an authority on this. Mm-hmm. But my understanding was at one point, there were separate, it was Monterey Union High School District or something like that, that was separate, and there were somewhat separate. When they went to unify, part of that was around the segregation and integrating schools. So that was part of the reason for the unification of the district. But I don't know a lot more than that, than what I've heard. In terms of, you know, well, what do you do now? I usually hear the argument in Monterey, that Monterey, some folks argue, if they were their own district, they would also be a basic aid district, which means you get, your property taxes are so high that you get to keep the property tax like Carmel and Pacific Grove. But in order to de-unify districts, there's a long process you have to follow, but one of the things the state has to determine is, will it have a negative impact on the remaining districts of the district? Usually it does, but it's usually, what you see is usually very wealthy areas trying to remove themselves from the unified district. That's most common. And so in state law, you cannot do that. It's going to have a negative impact on the remaining district. But in terms of why originally it happened, I've just told you what I heard. I don't know more specifics than that.
Thank you.
PK, glad you're here. I got two pretty quick questions. So you said the group that picks to prioritize the facility, the facility oversight committee?
No, so it's a facilities advisory committee.
Facility advisory.
Yeah. And just want to be clear, the board picks the projects. The facilities advisory committee advises staff, and then staff brings recommendations to the board.
That's fine. I think as a group here, we need to just make sure we're clear with the board about what we think the priorities are. Because it's not always on you. You're the professional, you're the administrator, and you take direction from the board, so we need to speak to the board about some of these things. Just to clear a couple of things, because I used to sit on the city council, as you know, and the kids still, from the school district, they still come and they need uniforms. And so I always ask myself, after we passed $110 million worth of bond to free up money for facilities, you would think $100,000 or $60,000 was free towards uniforms.
Yes.
But it never made it there. And not on UPK, but on your underlings, the excuse of we didn't rotate the uniforms, to me that's unacceptable.
What did they say?
Well, it's just like what you said, is they want to rotate buying uniforms, and we don't expect them to buy new uniforms every day, I mean every year. But I think one year the girls' soccer team came down there and they had uniforms that were 3 or 4 years old, but they were from the boys' basketball team. So their uniforms were 10 years old. And my point is, if the school districts are getting hundreds of million dollars to free up on facilities, it should be $20,000 or $30,000 to free up every year on uniforms. That's just a given. And then my last point is that, and I agree with everything President Mason said, I think it should be somewhere, PK, you can not recommend to the board, but if you could pass on to the board that they should look into a program within the MPUSD, partnering with some of these community organizations. And I won't just pick out the Bills Project, but I'll pick out CPY and everybody else that are really working. And you're doing those things. So why is the Village Project being left out? That's all I'm saying. It should be 360. They're in the community. You guys are in the community. The kids are in the community. Okay. So then I'm gonna move on. With the kids being in the community, yes, some go to Marina, some go to Monterey, but they all come back to this community. And so it's one thing to leave a rundown building in Monterey and go to a nice home in Monterey, but it's another thing to leave a rundown building and come back to not such a good community in Seaside. You know, I love Seaside. You know what I'm getting to. So those kids are being surrounded by it. And so when we talk about equity going through Marina, Monterey, and Seaside, I think at the board level, they should see sometimes it's a different community need more resources, not just equal, because we want to vote. We want to vote for the bond to be 80%, equity. So we share the facilities throughout the district. And I know that's one of the pressures you have, and I know it's one of the pressures they have, but at the end of the day, the need should be filled, and the need is not equal. So thank you for being here.
Well, thanks. So, just want to be clear about the facilities bond. You can only spend that money on facilities.
No, I know.
You can't say, okay, we're going to spend this money, but now we're going to spend bond money there and take that money.
You're not supposed to
spend it only on things you weren't spending it on before. Your point is that we need to get new uniforms on a more regular basis. I understand.
Let me be clear, PK. I know that the bond money is going to be spent on the facilities.
Yeah.
But part of your responsibility is uniforms. So if you had an extra $110 million, some money from somewhere should have been able to flow to uniforms. Mm-hmm. And I know the same thing with bond monies are not supposed to go to a salary, that ate up some money.
Yeah.
So
okay.
I'm with you.
Okay, that's good. I think I definitely understand that the principle that we, I think it's interesting in that I go to every community, they say a version of what you told me, meaning when you're in some communities, they say, why is all the money coming to Seaside? Seaside qualifies, Seaside has more schools that are free or reduced lunch, right? So they get extra Title I funding, which they should get, absolutely. But that's what we, get a criticism of, the tax base is here, we're the ones getting taxed, and then all the money goes to Seaside. I'm not saying it's true, I'm just telling you that there are a lot of different perspectives. Marina absolutely feels that they get nothing. They're the redheaded stepchild. They're not always left out. They don't even have their own gym. I think that there's truth in all of those situations, in that we have so much need. That when you have only a certain amount of money, it's very hard for anyone to feel like their needs are being met, because of the in a resource constrained environment. With that said, I definitely understand and agree with the principle of equity that the, you know, that more resources should be given to students who don't have a head start like others who are more privileged and trying to catch up to close opportunity gaps. You know, and I think, again, while the data needs to improve, we have shown in some areas we are closing those opportunity gaps and the kids are getting more opportunities than they had previously. So, yes.
So, am I hearing you correctly that it's the Facilities Advisory Committee that makes the decision?
No. No, that's what I tried to offer an alternative. So we have a Facilities Advisory Committee.
Is the Facilities Advisory Committee open to the community?
Yes.
So how does the community become a part of that Facilities Advisory Committee?
Yeah. So we had different members from each community. We try to have staff involved, so we try to have parents involved, community members involved. So we try to have a diverse set of community. Then those names are brought to the board, and the board ultimately, you know, says what's going to be the facility.
So the name is brought to the board
by superintendent. So it's a superintendent's advisory committee. Because the superintendent, the facilities advisory committee is advising the staff, which is a superintendent, to help make priorities and do that.
So if the community wanted to nominate or recommend someone to you, they need to submit those people's names to you?
That'd be fine, yep. That would work. Yeah, we took many names who were already on the Citizens Oversight Committee, which is the committee that makes sure you spend the money correctly. Some feedback we got from them was they wanted more say in not just whether you do the money correctly, but how you do the projects. And so some of those members also were on the Facilities Advisory Committee. But you can definitely reach out to me with ideas about who you think would be a good fit.
Okay, also before you leave today, I'd like to schedule an appointment with Mary and Ms. Hall and I with that issue that she was talking about, the war terrorists,
sure.
Because I've had two or three complaints about that same principle just this month. So we need to do that. And also, another parent here, Ms. Charles, had brought to my attention that I don't know if it's the football team or the basketball team that doesn't have transportation at Monterey High, but there are other sports teams. Elaborate on that, Ms. Charles, that what the issue was. The parents have to provide their own transportation.
Oh yeah, our basketball team, which this year is actually defending CCS Division III champions, do not have transportation, have not in several years. And so, for a prime example, we just won last week quarterfinals and are now going into semifinals. CCS playoffs on this Wednesday, which is the middle of the week. We should be hearing over the next few hours the time that we play, but parents such as myself will be forced to take off work to get our kids all the way to San Francisco to play in this game. And so it's very strenuous on our families, because that very same day, my 10-year-old daughter will have to miss her softball practice because I'm one person, one parent. So I have to pull her from her activity because the district doesn't provide transportation for my kid to get to where.
So what team did you say they do provide transportation for?
Football team.
And the girls, softball.
Who made that decision? Why is there?
Yeah, so I mean, we have very limited transportation is a challenge because both buses, but then also, you know, you have a number of routes that you have to run for special education, home to school, that type of thing. There's not like there's a ton of extra buses and or drivers. And I think that this decision was made, I think a while ago, I mean, it was, in other words, I have not changed it since I got here, but I think it was to try to provide for the most number of students. So football has the most number of kids, and then I think they do a female sport with the most number of students. And then I think they do in the spring, they do track and field, I'm pretty sure, for at least for some schools. So I think it was try to, you know, one bus, try to get as many, you know, students in there. But, you know, I mean, it's again, it's all, it's all about, you know, you have one pie, it's only so big. And it's all about how you so if you're going to pay for transportation, okay, that's probably another, if you're going to pay for all sports transportation is probably another $500,000. So then where are you going to take the $500,000 from? So that'd be the question I have. It's okay, if that's what we do and we prioritize that, then it's not as if we have another, you know, $500,000 just laying around. So does that mean we do less music? Or does that mean we make the sites pay for more supplies out of their supply budget? Or does that mean we don't have the social emotional counselor? You know, so I mean, it's all
of the SROs.
The board did fiscal stabilization plans because of the rise in pension costs, which for the cities, I'm sure you know about that. Pension costs and the burden placed on cities, districts, entities is rising rapidly. And so as a result, the district's having to take on more of that. We cut $5 million from our budget. And one of the decisions was after this year to not fund the SRO program from the district perspective. Meaning the cities, you know, they might fund it, but the sites aren't, the district isn't going to fund it. And we made a number of other really tough decisions. So, you know, I certainly understand, and I don't feel that any, you know, concern that has been brought up has been, you know, in a perfect world, I want to pay for everything. I want new uniforms, I want to drive the buses, I want, you know, to have brand new facilities for our nonprofit partners in addition to our schools. You know, there's a lot of things you want to do. And you have to make, unfortunately, in this environment, there are, you know, tough decisions and choices you are forced to make. There could be a Prop 13 ballot measure coming on that I urge you to look closely at that splits corporations away from individuals. And says, okay, for individuals, we're going to keep the Prop 13 protections, meaning your property tax will only go up 1%. You know, you're whatever. Corporations, we're going to remove those protections, right? Because right now, Apple is sitting in 1980 facility, paying 1980s taxes when they started their facility, right? For property taxes plus the 1%, you know, maximum. You know, they're a $1 trillion company. I think they could afford a little more. So
this couple over here had a question.
Oh yeah,
thank you. Well, I just wanted to mention that you actually can Google when you go to the MPUSD Facilities Advisory Committee. It takes you right to their website. The same thing with the Citizens Oversight Committee. In fact, on that website, the Citizens Oversight Committee, they have a place where you can click to get an application if you're interested. And they also will tell you whether they're actually applicants at the time. And they have an awful lot of information. It's almost, you know, it's clear to get as far as transparency. But you have an awful lot of information for both committees.
So what happens when you're not opening on the committees? We go online and there's applications, but if all the slots are filled, but you have no community representation, then what?
Well, we do have community representation on that. There's already
Seaside community representation.
Who is that person?
Wow.
We have Ruthie Watts is on the facility.
I want to mention that before coming on board, that I asked
asked about the community oversight committee, and I just looked into it myself and asked if I could be on it, and I was selected, but if you opt to, you're paid for it.
We have two current openings, so if you're interested, it would be a good time to apply. We have two vacancies on the citizens oversight committee.
And also, the meetings are open, so if you have something you want to address and talk about with government, you get your time to bring up what's on your mind.
It's a Brown Act committee, so you have to follow the procedures of the Brown Act.
At the school board meeting, basically, though, and thanks for coming, Mr. PK, thanks for coming as a school board member. We really appreciate you guys taking time out of your day to come, but my take, I am very community active, very hands-on. But I think the school board meetings are, how do I say this in a respectful, we agree to disagree way, basically are a joke, because you guys already have your mindset on what you're going to do, because there was no way that you had that auditorium full of opposition against those SROs. And then you voted, I mean, you already knew you were going to do that, so it's not a point. So it's not a point of, sometimes I think that we sit on board so long that we lose interest of what's best for the overall. We lose the sight of the people. We lose what's really going on with the people. That's why, PK, I said that. He made that joke that he heard that story three times. Now today made him hear the story four times, and it'll probably be five times that you really impressed me to be hands-on in that situation. It's because sometimes we sit on these diocese too long that we lose sight of what's really going on in the community. Community and people are suffering. And I work in a prison system where an 18-year-old is a sad indictment on any community. That an 18-year-old is stretched out in prison, because what is the community doing for its youth? Mm-hmm. Starting in the school. It's just unnecessary for that prison system to be filled up with 18-year-olds. Mm-hmm. I see kids in there, like, how old are you? And then I said, I apologize to you. Whatever community you came from, I apologize to you. Somewhere we failed. Mm-hmm. And it's because I think that sometimes when people get on these dioceses, they lose sight of what's really going on in the community, and it's just about what these positions are, because there's no way the school system should have had them SROs. That should have went down on their feet. But they just didn't want to hear the voice of the people.
Other people, they didn't care about you.
And the most troubled children are not getting the respect, especially the community. Because as well-intentioned as people may be, they don't know how to deliver services to the most troubled children. And there's no reason why parents don't get to come and be informed and be a part of the decision making. They show up. I mean, every little IEP meeting I've been going to with these kids, these people from special education already show up with everything hand filled out. So the parent can't even really provide input. Then they're asked to sign this stuff, and it's a legal document. So that's a whole other civil rights issue.
Yes.
But it's our fault, because we're allowing this supremacy type attitude and ideology to continue. So we're going to have to do something about
it. So, Mr. PK, I've been
Let's go to some direct questions before he has to go.
Okay. Yes. We're going to adjourn at 5 o'clock.
Okay. Let me share this.
There's time for any more questions.
This is really important. Parents are being harassed. Parents are being harassed by principals. And they're using the system of the health and welfare check at will. So I would like to see something done about that. Last year, the CROs are going to be gone in a year. You all are not putting them back in. But they overdid that so much that they're sending, there's a different process for truancy, and they're sending the CROs out to the house. SROs, my bad, I'm looking at the SRO down. I know it's SRO. But anyway, I'm dyslexic, so don't get me twisted. But anyway, they're sending them out to the house for health and welfare check and truancy. And so there's a different process for truancy. So there's a deputy DA that's being paid to handle the truancy in our county. And now the principals are taking it so far. And I'm saying this because I got a letter from the principal of Hill Terrace. My grandson, who went to Texas, had been missing in school for 6 days, and they sent 7 police officers to my house. So we're going too far with this stuff. And so what can you do about it? You may not even know about this stuff, but what can you do about the principals harassing family members when there's already a process in place for truancy and for other little health and welfare checks? We're going to check up on poor kids in our community.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm certainly can. I think we're going to sit
down.
We're
going to meet with you and discuss that directly.
Well, that was when a kid was pulled out of class and questioned about my grandson. That was an issue that I brought up to the NAACP. But I didn't mention this. You know, my grandson who went to Texas, another kid was pulled out by that principal to question. And then they still sent the cops out.
Foothill was a pilot and it went very well and we probably expanded to all our elementary and middle and
middle schools.
Just the pilot just finished.
Because my next question is what Ms. Mason was talking about, and that is having some funds for parent advocacy. As a volunteer, I get so many parents requesting that I attend IEP meetings, which sometimes go 5, 6, 8 hours, 7 days, and they don't know what's going on, they don't know the process. Someone needs to be hired, or funds need to be released from the district to help the parents to navigate through the IEP process. Otherwise, it's all futile. Like Ms. Mason is saying, they go in there, it's already filled out all of the forms, it's a legal document, and the real human rights and civil rights of the students and the parents are not being addressed. And it's taxing our organization and our resources. Sometimes I'm being threatened with divorce because I'm going to these meetings so long, but we really need some help in the community to make a difference and make it easier not only for the parents and the students, but for the teachers, for the district. If we can eliminate some of the problems that the children are being faced with, then it will make the classroom a lot more conducive for learning. So how can we help you to or allocate funds for parent advocacy?
Outside of the district, because when you pay one of your people, then they have to conform to the ideology of the district, and it may not be culturally congruent for any culture of person.
So I have to look into how district funds would be paid for a non-district employee. I'm not sure how that would work, because if you're paying someone.
Well, LCAP can do whatever it wants when this next go around. The parent says, because in Oakland and San Jose, they've got communities doing all kinds of different things with that LCAP fund.
LCAP can be used towards three different things. The students, socially disadvantaged students, English learners, or students in foster care. Those are the LCAP funding is intended to be supplemental concentration funding, which is above and beyond the base funding. It's intended to go to those three students.
The first one?
Socioeconomically disadvantaged. Yeah. And then the LCAP process in terms of the community engagement is this, the state has laid out 8 priorities that your LCAP must cover. And then you engage your community in terms of prioritization on what they would like to see, right? What's most important to them. And then the district takes that input and through that input develops an LCAP plan that then is presented to the board and the board is approved. So it is a process where we get parent input and community input. It's not a process, I don't know how they do it in San Jose, but as it's been explained to me, it's not a process where community says, this amount of money goes to this organization. That's not, it's a prioritization process where
the person having the bond
does the
over.
Yeah, we're passing a bond, so that bond money that you would have had to use for facilities can come from the general fund. I mean, you're coming asking these communities to pass a bond for $200 million, then you can reallocate some of the general fund money that that bond would have to pay for to, into, you can be creative, think outside the box and be innovative. But I know it's not just you, the board has to make their decision, and we really need to be talking to the school district board, because they're the ones that get to decide how the money gets spent in their recommendation. But we do want to get your expertise on.
Yeah, and I want to form a partnership, and we'd love it to sit down. To me, a partnership is both hands are extending to each other. It's not, this is where I am, and you need to meet me over here, or we're not going to be a partner. That's, to me, that's not a partnership. To me, we're trying to work together to go around common goals.
Exactly.
I'm all for that.
And it's also that the Black community's been left behind. In my opinion, based on all these cases,
this ill cap that Alana just passed out for an online survey, is it possible for people who don't have internet access to get a hold of the survey?
Yeah, I think we can print it out for people and they can just do it.
I guess I'm asking, does a printout of the survey go home to the students? How widely distributed is the survey?
It's online.
It's online.
No, but if you don't have...
A lot of parents don't have it.
Thus far, we have not put it in the back, put it for the kids to do, to take it home. I haven't necessarily found that that's, a super great way to get feedback, but we can try, print it out and send it.
Let me just jump in. We keep going on and on. Can't the district just have copies of that at the school site for parents to pick up?
And give them to the churches and.
We need hard copy.
And I want to ask a quick,
Can I just say one thing? Sorry. So I have a parent meeting in Marina, so I'm going to have to go pretty soon.
Okay.
I got to go too.
All right. Okay. Well, let me just add, commitment to equity, right? And so, PK, I just want, if you could take, I know it's short, but if you could just take a good 60 seconds, 90 seconds about what have, not you personally, but what has the district done under your leadership to improve the African Americans' standing graduation rate? Meaning, what programs should we be looking for to support, because these are making a difference in these kids' lives?
I'd say this, the single, I'll get to that answer, but I just want to set the context. So the single greatest in-school factor that determines a student's achievement is the quality of instruction happening in the classroom. That's what study after study shows that, right? In-school factor, a lot outside of school factors, but in-school factor. So we've invested heavily in improving the quality of our instruction. What does that mean? It's looking at hiring practices and making sure we're letting people in that have strong background. It's keeping the tenure bar high, because after you get tenure, it's virtually impossible to let go of a teacher for performance only. You can do it for other reasons, not just performance. So the tenure bar has to be very high. It's investing in instructional leadership teams at the site, academic coaching, professional learning communities. All those things go into improving the level of our instruction. That's the single greatest factor. In terms of other things we've done, investing in an intervention teacher at sites that can pull out kids and do small group instruction, small group instruction. So that's another thing we've invested. I'd say I look for the social emotional support, the counselors on campus, what they're doing, and positive behavior intervention support. I look at the suspension rates. How is that improving? Is that getting? We're close to not being. I don't know if we'll get there this year. It might even take one more year, but we're close to not being disproportionate in our suspension rates for African American kids. Go look it up on the state. How disproportionate the stadiums for African American kids or the country. It's troubling, right?
Yeah.
We're almost there. We're almost getting there. So I look, the quality of the school culture, sort of school climate. So that includes we do a student survey every year and ask them questions like, are you held to high expectations? Do you have a parent? Do you have a teacher who cares for you? How much is this environment supportive of your for you? So different things like that that I think tell us whether we're on the right track. Our after school programs and we have invested in that early childhood education. I mean a lot of stuff I've outlined. There isn't going to be a program.
Okay.
It's a system.
Right.
How do you create a system? How do you create systems of support that we're trying to create a multi-tiered system of support where at each level of increased need we have services that meet that need. And our kids have a lot of need. They're overcoming a lot, they're dealing with a lot. So, I think there's a number of things that I think we've done. We've started ethnic studies. We have an ethnic studies course for all freshmen. We've tried to connect with the kids, cultural heritage, support that. We started the Black Student Union at Seaside High. At Seaside, middle Seaside High, every student gets a computer. They can take it home. Try to close the digital divide for kids who don't have access to technology. Still need to figure out the internet at home piece, but I would recommend, and I'd be happy to do it with you, coming and touring some of our sites and kind of seeing them for yourself. Go on Seaside Middle School's campus right now and tell me it's not transformed from what it was 3 years ago.
Oh, yeah.
This thing is night and day.
No, we can see it, BK, and I really wanted you just to focus us on things we need to be looking on to reevaluate, but consistently evaluate you and the board.
Yeah.
Because you guys have made changes, and we want to celebrate the positive and enforce the positive. So we've right. seen the difference.
All right.
I want to ask you a question. We're going to have an LCAT meeting for our community, for the African American community here in Seaside. So when that process comes available, yeah, we'll just notify our organization so that we can schedule that. Okay. And thank you so very much for coming. We appreciate it.